Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will discuss the modified partial thickness flap technique. It is also known as legend wedge technique. Previously we have discussed the conventional technique. Now we are going to discuss its modification. So let's try to understand what is the modification and why the name legend wedge technique. So the first point about this technique is it was introduced by Oschenbein in the year 1958. And then by Oschenbein and Bohannon in the year 1963, okay? First in the year 1958, then in the year 1963. But it was highly popularized by Pritchard. Okay, so this is the first point. Now talking about its name, ledge and wedge technique. So that means this technique has two stages or two phases. Remember, not two visits. Two stages or phases. Everything will be conducted in one sitting, but there are two stages. Okay. The first stage is gingivectomy, and the second stage is the partial thickness flap technique. Okay. But the main drawback of this technique is the interdental areas are left open to heal via secondary indentation, and that is the major drawback. The interproximal area heals by secondary indentation. Why? Because the stage 1, which is also known as gingivectomy, this gingivectomy performed is a straight incision gingivectomy and not a scalloped incision gingivectomy. If you refer the book, textbook Linde, it has already discussed both the types of gingivectomy. One is straight incision and the other one is scalloped or beveled incision. What we perform routinely is a beveled incision gingivectomy where we give scallopings, right? But here in this technique, we perform a straight incision gingivectomy, and that is why all of the interproximal tissue is excised, is resected. That is why post-operative, the interproximal areas are left open to heal via obviously secondary indentation. So this is a major drawback, and that is why this technique cannot be combined with the other flap techniques or gingival surgical techniques, which requires a complete primary closure. Okay. So these are the few points about legend wedge technique. Talking about the name, very briefly, we will discuss it alongside the main surgical procedure discussion. But in brief, just to begin with, it is called ledge and wedge technique because we have already discussed there are two stages. So in the first stage, we perform gingivectomy, which is obviously, as already mentioned, straight incision gingivectomy, and thereby a ledge is created. With the help of or at the end of this stage 1 of gingivectomy, a straight incision gingivectomy, a ledge is created which permits visualization of the palatal flap thickness. Okay. And then in the second stage, after the ledge is created, then we give our partial thickness flap incisions, all the set of incisions under partial thickness flap procedure, in which as a result of which the combination of these incisions will result into excision or resection of a wedge of tissue. Okay. So in stage 1 we get a ledge, and in stage 2 we resect a wedge of the tissue. That is why the name of this technique also ledge and wedge technique. So now let's discuss the technique in detail. I hope these points are clear to you till now. Now we will discuss the surgical procedure. So under the surgical procedure, first we will discuss the stage 1, which is gingivectomy. Okay. Gingivectomy. So the two major differences between a regular gingivectomy and the gingivectomy portion in this technique are, first, no need to mark the pockets, no need of a pocket marker, a periodontal probe should be sufficient. Okay, because anyways we are going to perform the second difference, straight incision. Okay, straight incision gingivectomy and not a beveled or scalloped incision gingivectomy. Clear? So now we will begin the gingivectomy. So with this red color marker, just to differentiate all the types of incisions here, we will begin from the terminal, distal end of the terminal portion, just to include the distal wedge along with it. Okay, so this is the kind of straight incision. Okay, now the main point about this straight incision is it should be slightly above or at the crest of the alveolar bone. Okay, this is an important point. We cannot give it randomly anywhere. Okay, so obviously a pre-surgical diagnostic probing is performed, which is also known as bone sounding or transgingival probing, which helps us determine any underlying topography, osseous topography defects. It also helps us determine the pocket depth and the tissue thickness. Okay, so with the help of the transgingival probing, we have already understood these parameters. Okay, so now our straight incision will be just slightly above. In this picture, if you can understand, this is our crest of the alveolar bone. So this straight incision goes something this, just above or at, slightly above or at. Now I will tell you why it should be slightly above, why it should be at. Okay, see, if it is slightly above, we are on the safer side. Why? Because if we place our incision at the crest of the alveolar bone, then this tissue thickness, if this tissue is very thick and our incision is at the crest of the alveolar bone, after removing the wedge of the tissue, when the flap is adapted back post-operatively, it may fall short. That is why our incision should be on a safer side, slightly. I am not telling very much. If it is very much above, then it will result in post-operative pockets and even recurrent pocketing, and then the entire purpose is fail. Okay, so that is why our incision, our gingivectomy incision, should be at or slightly, very slightly above, just to allow the flap adaptation over the crest of the alveolar bone. The second scenario, if we place our incision at the crest of the alveolar bone and the tissue is very thick, out of which a huge amount or huge thickness of tissue is removed in form of wedge for the sake of thinning, then the tissue adaptation will not take place. The flap which will be positioned after post-operatively, it will fall short of it and the bone crest will remain exposed. So this will result in more patient discomfort and as well the healing will be delayed. Okay, so this is one important point to be kept in mind. Our straight incision gingivectomy should be slightly above or at the crest of the alveolar bone, and then with the help of periodontal knives, this tissue is resected. So with the help of this straight incision gingivectomy, this tissue is resected. Okay, so now I'll erase this tissue for the sake of our understanding as we progress into the surgical technique procedure. Okay, so now understood, this tissue is resected with the help of straight incision gingivectomy. Okay, yeah, so this is the scenario after stage 1. So stage 1 is very simple. It is straight incision gingivectomy, slightly above or at the crest of the alveolar bone. Okay, and the two main differences between a regular gingivectomy that we perform and this gingivectomy: no need of a pocket marker, a periodontal probe is sufficient. Second, we do straight incision gingivectomy and not a beveled or scalloped incision. Okay, now This is what we call ledge. So the first part of the name is understood. This is a ledge which is created. Now you can see the entire thickness of the tissue is now visible. Okay. This tissue thickness is now clearly visible. So this ledge permits visualization of the entire palatal flap thickness. Okay. So now we will proceed on to our stage 2, which is partial thickness flap procedure. So this is the major modification. In partial thickness flap procedure, we used to directly give our thinning incision. Sorry. In the conventional technique, we began the procedure with the thinning incision, primary incision of the partial thickness flap. But here we are initiating or beginning the procedure with the gingivectomy. So this is the major modification, and that is why the name modified partial thickness flap technique. And now we are understanding the entire procedure and simultaneously decoding the reason behind the alternative technique, ledge and wedge technique name. Okay. So stage 1 gingivectomy is completed, which results in formation of a ledge which permits visualization of the palatal flap tissue thickness. Okay. Now moving on to the stage 2, which is partial thickness flap technique. In this we have a set of incisions altogether which will result in formation of a wedge of a tissue which is resected ultimately. So the first incision is primary incision or thinning incision. Okay. So this primary incision so now once the tissue thickness is assessed, this is the bone crest. Okay. So now we will decide how much to resect and how much to retain. So let's assume we want this much tissue to be retained and this thickness of tissue to be resected. So now our primary incision will be somewhere here. And the important point is it should be parallel, should be straight and very much within the limits of the vertical height of the alveolar bone. See the direction of the incision, it should be straight and not, and I'll just draw an alternative scenario. It should not follow the slope of the alveolar crest bone. Okay. It should not follow the slope of the bone. Otherwise, you may end up approaching the palatal artery. This is the major concern which we should keep in mind while performing palatal flaps, the damage to the palatal artery. So while giving our primary incision, which is also known as thinning incision, we should stay within the vertical height of the alveolar bone and not go with the slope of the alveolar bone. Otherwise, we may end up approaching or damaging the palatal artery. Okay. So this is an important point here. First incision, thinning or primary incision. Okay. And then second incision is scoring incision. So scoring incision is to detach it from the underlying periosteum. Okay. This is scoring incision. And then the third incision is secondary incision, which is given around the neck of the teeth and interproximally. Okay. So the resultant, this wedge of the tissue, is removed. Okay. So with the help of this set of incisions, primary or thinning incision, scoring incision and a secondary incision, this wedge of tissue is now removed. Okay, with the help of chisels and rongers. And then now once this set of tissue is resected. I'll remove the tissue so that we proceed further on to this surgical technique. Okay, just approximately. So now we have something like this. Clear? I hope this technique is getting clear to all of you. I am trying my level best to bring you the simplified version of this topic. So now proceeding to the next step. So now after these set of incisions which were represented in blue marker, now we are left with this surgical scenario. Okay. So now this bone is exposed and we have this newly thinned flap. Okay. Now what we should do is, if any osseous irregularities are observed, we should perform the osseous correction procedures. We should perform scaling, root planing, and just clean off all the debris. And once the new bone architecture, if indicated, is formed, now we should adapt this flap margin, the newly created thin flap, onto this newly created or the existing bone architecture. Okay, the flap adaptation should be confirmed. I will redraw the flap maybe in a new color to understand the difference in blue marker. Okay, so this flap is now adapted here. Okay, like this. This blue indicates the post-operative flap margins adapted against the crest of the alveolar bone. Just observe the adaptation between the bone and the flap margins, the thin flap margins. There is absolutely no pocket or very little sulcus. So there are very less chances of post-operative pocketing. Okay. So this is the final scenario. Now the last step here is suturing. So the suturing technique here will be sling suture, be it interrupted or continuous, but it will be sling suture. Okay, onto this, if we understand, after this resection of technique, and finally let's assume our flap adaptations look like this here, then we perform sling suturing, which will be around the neck of the teeth. It may be continuous, it may be interrupted. Now you may ask, why sling suture, why not direct interrupted sutures or continuous interrupted sutures, which are the most common sutures used in periodontal flap surgery technique. The answer is, if you remember the drawback of this technique. In this technique, the only drawback is the interdental tissue is left open to heal via secondary intention. So there is no interdental tissue here wherein we can give direct interrupted suture. That we only have the buccal flap intact and the palatal flap with only this much portion. If you can see the straight incision, which was the result of the stage 1 gingivectomy, which was performed by straight incision. So we don't have any interdental tissues here. That is why we are going to suture this newly created palatal flap with the help of sling sutures. Clear? So this is the entire technique. A quick recap. Stage 1 gingivectomy, straight incision gingivectomy without the help of any pocket markers or marking the pockets. Simple straight incision gingivectomy and the tissue resection with the help of a periodontal knife, which results in the formation of a ledge. Sorry, this tissue is resected and the formation of a ledge. And onto this ledge, which permits the visualization of tissue thickness, we perform the stage 2, which is partial thickness flap procedure. The set of incisions, the primary thinning incision within the vertical height of the alveolar bone and not following the slope. Otherwise, we may end up meeting palatal artery. Second incision is the scoring incision to detach it from the underlying periosteum, and the third incision, secondary incision interproximally and around the neck of the teeth, altogether removing this wedge of the tissue, and thereby we achieve this thinned palatal flap, okay, which is then adapted after the osseous corrections if indicated, scaling root planing, and removing all the deposits The flap margin is adapted. The newly created thin flap is adapted to the bone architecture with the help of sling suture. Okay. So this is the technique. Now we will discuss the various mistakes or errors which may occur in this technique. I hope the technique is clear to all of you till now. Now we will discuss the mistake. So the first mistake is, and the most common is, short flap. We have already discussed it many a times. So the reason should be the answer, how to rectify it. Okay, it can be anything. So under short flap, it may be our gingivectomy. As already discussed, our gingivectomy incision should be slightly above or at the crest of the alveolar bone. But if we put it at the crest of the alveolar bone and the tissue is too thick, and then we remove a huge wedge of the tissue in the stage 2, then the resultant thin flap may not adapt exactly at the crest of the alveolar bone and it may fall short of it. So the resultant post-operative scenario will have an exposed bone crest. Okay. So this results in patient's discomfort and delayed healing, and of course not to forget too much of post-operative bone loss. Obviously there will be certain amount of bone loss, but an exposed bone will result in more bone loss. Okay. So our gingivectomy incision should be kept on a safer side, slightly above the crest of the alveolar bone, just to avoid a short flap post-operatively. Second reason for a short flap will be deep primary incision in the stage 2. Remember, as we already discussed, it should be straight within the vertical height of the alveolar bone and not going too deep. Okay, if we give it too deep, we may end up removing a lot of wedge of the tissue and then a short flap. Okay, and the third reason could be using bevel gingivectomy. Already discussed, a bevel gingivectomy does no good in this procedure, and that is why we should always perform straight incision gingivectomy in this technique, not routinely, only for the sake of this technique. Okay, so this is the first error. The second error could be under thinning. The thinning what we perform in the stage 2 is less under thinning. Okay, not a big problem. But yes, doing the additional thinning, the answer or the solution for under thinning is, the additional thinning can be performed after the flap surgery is almost completed, like before suturing, while adapting the procedure. If we think that there's a lot of tissue and the tissue adaptation doesn't go well, we may perform additional thinning, but again it's a skillful procedure. So we must ensure that our flap is thinned accurately at the time of that step in the surgical technique. Okay, and the second reason for under thinning should be looked for. As I already told, the etiology should be the answer. The rectification or correction of the etiology should be the solution, and not just anything and everything works. Okay, so for under thinning as well, we should look for any other irregularities present, and why the tissue adaptation is not taking place. It can be any other reason also apart from under thinning. Okay, the third point can be, as already discussed, tissue adaptation is not taking place. Okay, so why the tissue adaptation is not taking place? The answer can be any underlying osseous irregularities, or the another reason could be a very thick tissue which is just resulting too much above the crest of the alveolar bone, and hence post-operative pocketing or even recurrent pocketing. So the solution here is, our primary thinning incision should be performed accurately. Our pre-operative diagnostic sounding measurements should really help us in giving our incisions accurately. Okay, and then the next set of mistakes are related to palatal artery damage. See, our deep thinning incision, as I've already repeated multiple times, deep thinning incision, our incision should be very much within the vertical height of the crest of the alveolar bone and not go with the slope of the alveolar bone, otherwise we may end up damaging the palatal artery. So we should be very careful with our deep thinning incision. It shouldn't be too deep. Okay, and the same and one more factor which may lead to palatal artery damage is in a low broad palate. okay, also maybe a shallow palate. Okay, in a shallow palate also we should be very careful with our incisions. Otherwise, if we try to give regular measurement incision in a low palate, we may again end up damaging the palatal artery. Okay, so these are the few common errors or mistakes associated with modified partial thickness flap procedure, also known as legend wedge technique. I repeat: short flap, under thinning of the flap, tissue adaptation, deep thinning incision, and low incisions on a low and broad palate. Okay, so a quick summary of this technique given by Oschenbein in the year 1958 and by Oschenbein and Bohannon in 1963, but highly popularized by Pritchard. Okay, and then the main drawback: the interproximal tissues are left open to heal via secondary intention, and so it cannot be clubbed with other surgical techniques which requires complete primary closure. Clear? Two stages. Stage one is a gingivectomy, straight incision gingivectomy without the use of pocket markers. Just a periodontal probe is sufficient, and a straight incision is given with the help of periodontal knife. This tissue is resected. This is the tissue that is resected, and a ledge is created. That ledge permits visualization of the tissue thickness, the palatal flap tissue thickness. And then stage 2 begins. The stage 2 is partial thickness flap procedure. Incision number 1, the primary or the thinning incision, which should be within the vertical height of the alveolar bone and not go with the slope, otherwise palatal artery damage can occur. Second incision is the scoring incision to detach it from the underlying periosteum. Third incision is secondary incision interproximally and around the neck of the teeth. Okay, so the secondary inner flap is then reflected. This tissue ledge is created, wedge is resected. Okay, that's why the name legend wedge technique. Okay, after the wedge resection, this newly created thin flap, palatal flap, it has to be adapted with the bone crest or bone. Before that, the bone architecture should be assessed for any irregularities if present and corrected if any. Scaling, root planing, and cleaning of all the debris should be done. Once the bone is clean, and then this newly created thin flap is adapted to the bone, and sling sutures are provided. Clear? And these are the set of common errors or mistakes in this technique. I hope this topic is clear to all of you. But if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or onto my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com or on my FB Messenger or Instagram DM. I am available on my social media platforms to reply your queries. Okay. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, and stay safe.